Hi, I'm Tori.
Hi, I'm Wendy.
Hi, Tori, what are you studying? I just so happen to be a political science major. What about you?
Me too.
Wow.
Could you tell me some more about the Chinese liberalization process?
Absolutely. Before economic reform in China, the Chinese economy was segregated to keep domestic investments secure. Chinese people were kept from having a more developed economy with a centralized planning system that limited trading with other countries and also controlled investments. Chinese citizens did not have any kind of help from previous policies that would make their standards of living any better. In the end, the Chinese were isolated and did not compete with other countries in Asia and the rest of the world.
Well, that's really interesting. Let me tell you something about Russia. You see, Russia has always had a strong controlling ways of ruling, both in politics and in economics. Under Gorbachev in the 1980s, the economics and politics became slightly looser. Under Perestroika and Glasnost, the Russians had more freedoms than they were used to. The nation's post-Soviet demise and re-emergence as a crucial political powerhouse and an international energy supplier places global integration high on Russia's domestic strategic agenda. However, because its history lies greatly on strict rules and regulations, a more transparent and free model would ultimately cause much more confusion and economic downturn.
And now, let's discuss China. In 1978, Deng Xiaoping became China's most powerful leader and put the nation on the path towards fast economic growth. China did not want to have any political problems, so it only worked on ways to improve the economy while keeping their authoritarian system. Deng Xiaoping made the revival of the rural economy the most important part of introducing China to the household responsibility system, the HRS, which dramatically improved food security for the nation. The 1994 tax reforms introduced a lot of changes to China's tax structure, which were meant to transform the fiscal, monetary, and foreign exchange policies. The parts of the 1994 tax reform included the shift from turnover taxes to value-added taxes, agreement of enterprise income tax rates for different types of enterprises, changes in personal income tax, and reforms in the financial relationship between the central and local government. Overall, the reforms changed the types of taxation, total supply, and monetary influences of the new taxes. But it was not until 1997 that a price law passed that allowed the market to determine prices. To have a free market economy, in 1999, China started to join the World Trade Organization, the WTO. With the membership, there would be foreign companies outside of China and Chinese markets increasing the investment in new technologies to help China develop.
Finally, in 2001, China became the 143rd member of the WTO.
Present-day China leads as the world's third largest trading economy after the United States and Germany, proving a success in the policy reforms that were put into effect during the Xi Jinping administration.
Thank you, Tori. And now, Russia.
To understand Russian economic reform, you must first understand that Russia always had a strong authoritarian method of ruling, both in economics and in politics. Yeltsin decided to use the shock therapy method as a method to transition from a socialist economy to a capitalistic one. In essence, it would launch a massive privatization of formerly state-owned companies and institutions, as well as healthcare organizations and other public services. In 1998, Russia experienced a crisis through Yeltsin's reforms. Although Yeltsin's reforms made the Russian economy more liberalized, the policies he established, such as shock therapy, failed miserably. The wake of the 1998 crisis left Russia in shambles. The ruble was devalued. Foreign investors felt incredibly discouraged from investing into the Russian economy, and the state seemed very unlikely to successfully reform the economy in the eyes of the Westerners. In 2000, Putin expressed his desire for Russia to become a strong, economic, politically stable, and internationally respected nation.
To be good. 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 Both China and Russia shared the economic goal of emerging into a free market system. China's reform began before Russia's in 1978 under the Xi Jinping administration, who focused on prioritizing reforms of the rural economy.
The process in China was gradual, but over the course became more immediate and effective. On the other hand, Russian reform was focused on sudden liberalization and privatization.
In essence, this meant that state-controlled corporations were rapidly privatized and allowed access to the free market. Because of this sudden change, the Russians failed to achieve successful reform.
Well, that was fun.
Holy!
In conclusion, the economic growth that China and Russia experienced are due to the reforms and alteration in the national policies. The Chinese effectively transitioned from a central command economy to a free market system. In contrast, the Russians required more help to allow their economy to fully make a more triumphant transition. However, both nations continue to grow economically and continue to preside relevance on the international stage.